turn up my 52 tooth sprocket and split it. And I have a couple of bobbins here that help align it. Slip in like that. Tighten up. Helps keep the gaps the same on both sides. It's quite easy to get the gaps different sizes, which doesn't help with the alignment. And sometimes get the chain going slack and tight because of it. Right, get that one round. So a good fit onto the hub there. And then you've got M8 bolts that go into threaded holes, and on the back of them, additionally, there'll be lock nuts, nylon lock nuts to stop these bolts coming back out. Washer, that's what I need. I'll also use some Loctite on the bolts as well, just as extra locking. Dabs. Right. Just start putting the nuts on this side because there's just a small gap that they fit into. Can't get my fingers in there either. So get them started. Loosely, a couple on each side. I find if you just go and horse a couple straight up, it can pull the sprocket one way or the other, and the gaps can change. The alignment bosses help, but not foolproof. So you get a couple of these in and lightly tighten them up before you go crazy. Right, I'll go and fit the other six of these and get the nuts on the back and then torque them up. That's all the fixings for the sprocket in, torqued up, and the lock nuts on. A lot of condensation in here today. It's been a bit mild and wet outside, and it's been cold in here. Swarf out of the teeth of the sprockets. Bearing carrier's got a slice out of it there so that we can get in and remove these bolts with the thing in situ if necessary, and similarly on the other side the cutout clears the motor for the electric reverse. Differential's lubricated with grease. It's got five grease nipples, one for each of the cross barrels on the ATB type differential. I pre-grease them before I assemble them, and then you can pump in more grease as required. There will be oil seals on these output shafts that will run on this journal here, that stops any dirt going in. There shouldn't be much grease trying to get back out. So, I need to drop that back in the car. Still got condensation on them. No wonder things rust in here. So, I can drop that back in the car, try not to trap my fingers on the sharp teeth. And then I can go and size the chain up. I need to change the sprocket on the engine as well. Put a 15 tooth sprocket on that. That sprocket arrived today, along with this one. Right, try and get this sprocket off. Nut is a 27mm. Let's see if it'll come off with this electric rattle gun. One nut, should be a washer, lock washer as well, and a stuck on sprocket. Okay. Oh, what size was that one? What was that? 17. I think. No, it was a 16. It was a 16. I'm going with a 15. Amazingly, the 15 tooth one slipped straight on, no bother at all. The one that was on it must have been slightly deformed, because it did not want to come off. It was that one just slipped straight on, didn't even need to hammer it. So I just need to put the lock washer and the nut back on and torque it up. Not the most powerful device, this it's a Clark one, so not a patch on a decent one, but it gets there. So that's it in with the sprocket on and the front sprocket as well. Tomorrow I shall go and cut a chain to length, then think about starting on the drive shafts. I've got a couple of brand new Sierra drive shafts that I can cut to length and weld, and I've got the 100mm Lobro CV joints as well. I'm going to be using an EK drag racing chain. This is a known O-ring type chain that's one of the strongest ones out there. It should minimise any tendency to stretch the chain with aggressive starts. It's still not indestructible, but it's reputed to be one of the strongest ones. If I was using the vehicle on the road, I would use an O-ring or an X-ring chain. Usually use a DID 530 ZVMX on the road. But, I'll try this for the sprint and hill climb car with the big sticky tyres on it. So get out of the box and figure out the length it needs to be cut to. Should be able to get two complete chains out of this. This is a 150 link chain,
So if I cut it in two, I can get 274 link chains or any other suitable combination. As in, it's got a clip type link rather than a rivet type link, which makes it easier to change the chain and to change the sprocket and such like, without having to split it or take the axles out.
One lovely sticky chain. Feed it through here, over the other sprocket. Back round. The mount slid all the way forward, so that's its closest possible position. In which case that one will fit there. So I need to grind off the plate on that one. Put it and replace that with a link. So if it doesn't move, I shall mark it. I can find something to mark it with.
Right, I ground off the rivets off the side plates and took out the link. That was that one I ground off, and that's the new clip link there. So I've got a 68 link chain to go on. So we'll be able to get two out of that, because you can certainly get 268s out of a 150.
That's the two halves of the chain. Right, I've got this clip link going. Get out of the bag. We'll be using the bits. Plate all the way on. Need to use a clamp to pull that one all the way in. Need to squeeze that together to get the plate all the way on, and then put the little clip, and that goes facing backwards. The open end at the back. Right, tension is not too bad. You don't want it too tight. It might just be about on the verge of being tight enough. Just when you tighten up the bolts, it can sometimes draw it a little more. But that's a bit trial and error. So if it's too tight, just slacken them again. Slacken it off slightly and re-tighten them. I think we'd be quite lucky with the drive shaft on this side. Normally the shaft bar would be 16mm shorter than the distance from the bottom of the cup to the bottom of the cup on the other side. I reckon I'm about 20mm too short on the bar, the standard bar, but I do have a special spacer I can make up, just drill that for the holes, and that can fit straight onto the output shaft and the CV joint. The Lobro CV joint there can fit straight onto that. Right side of it, need to bore that. That side out very slightly. Now that was obviously, I was going to make a spacer for a conversion one from a 94 up to 100, so it's 100 on that side, 94 on that. So bore that side out to 100 as well, and it fits straight onto the flanged output. And the coupling will go onto that, and that will take up the requisite 20mm that I'm short. And that saves me cutting and welding one of these shafts, which will be good. Measuring these shafts with the shafts at the shortest possible length, that's when the axles are horizontal and in line with the differential, and in line fore and aft as well. So the shafts should only get shorter as the wheels go up and down. Well, the distance between the upright and the flange will get shorter. The shaft stays the same length. It's taken up by the movement in the CV joint, moves in and out. Both the drive shafts on now. So I'll just lower it to the ground and connect up the electric reverse and see if it will move backwards.